say this past year, 2022, that this church has been 100% more times than not. I haven't really checked, looked them up, but that's something new for us, isn't it? That's great. If we believe in the Lord, and if we believe in the Bible, we ought to have witness, shouldn't we? Especially on Sunday. We're open in prayer, praying for this box of names. Do not want to forget to pray for the prayer request that's in this box. And I know that we're still having prayers, and that's great. That's the way it ought to be, because there are enough people, and it includes all 11 of us, that surely there is at least one prayer every week, right? So if someone you hear says, I have a need for prayer, don't forget to give them one of those prayer slips. And I think we won't have to worry about running out of these. And write their name on that as a prayer request. And you don't even have to write the prayer request on it. If they won't tell you what the need is, just simply knowing the name that that person has, I have a need for prayer. God knows. And he will answer those prayers. God is in the prayer answering business. And that's awesome, isn't it? That's wonderful. Let's pray. Lord, our Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for making it possible that we might be here. Lord, we thank you for this church. We thank you for each member of it. Lord, we pray for those that are members here, but they haven't been for a while. We would ask, Lord, that you bring them back, that they might and we might worship together with them again. Lord, we pray for those that are lost, those that do not have a church home to call their own, where they can come and be in your presence and worship you. Lord, this morning we pray for your word, that it might touch our lives in such a way that we will know what you would have for us to do. Lord, we just pray for your honor and glory to be done. Be with us, go with us, guide and direct us, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Take your Bibles, if you will, and turn to Isaiah, the 53rd chapter. That will be our beginning scripture. 53rd chapter of Isaiah. Can't help but note that we're in Isaiah in the Sunday school class too. See how God works? We can see him if we'll only look. Because he's with us 24/7. And he's with us every Sunday for sure. The second scripture that we're going to be looking at is a comparison of that scripture and ties the New Testament in with the Old Testament. Here is another way that we can see God's word fulfilling God's promise to us and rest assured that God's not dead. He's here. He's all around us. We just have to look. We sometimes just have to listen, don't we? And he'll speak to us. All right, I don't know if anybody else is aware of the fact. Probably Wayne, if he has his hearing aids in. But it's a different voice that I'm speaking with, and I'm not quite accustomed to it yet. So to me, I'm sounding funny. I don't know about you. I think I'm getting that new variant that I heard this morning. think that God has a message here for us. And I just want to interest you in looking up some things from now on around. And I've got a song that's playing on my mind. And you might want to grab the red book and look up this song. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hill, and everywhere. Is that in the red book? I don't have a song book that I can, tear apart that is like the red book, but it, the one I took it out of is a red book.
182.
182, okay. Well, this one is 82. It's probably a red book too. But that's good. It's in it. Go tell it along the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. That's a Christmas song, right? But it tells about the birth of our Savior. And I pray that he's your servant too. What I want to talk about is, who's going to believe? Who's going to believe? Shepherds, the Christmas story, it says that shepherds abiding in their fields, keeping watch over their sheep, when the angel appeared to them and told them the story about the birth of a Savior. And they said, let's go see. Let's go see. Which they did. And you wonder about the Christmas story. I'm sure it was told in many and many a household around our world. Maybe in a lot of the households around this church. And who do you think is going to believe that story? Well, Isaiah has something to say on the lines of who's going to believe. In the 53rd chapter of verse 1 says, who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord? Some time ago I gave out these little slips of paper and asked you to put your favorite need that you would like to see this church do. And this one that I'm going to put in the box this morning says, to know God is here. This message this morning is probably along that line. Just to know that God is here. He's not dead. We can fully rely on him every day of our lives. And we can also know that he's here today. And he'll be here next Sunday, as long as you come. But you have to come here to know that he's going to be here, and he'll be here next Sunday. Sometimes we go and we tell people, about Jesus, and about our church, and about our Christian life that we live for him. And we don't know whether they believe us or not, right? And that's kind of what I see Isaiah doing here in this first verse of this 53rd chapter, is who's believing? Who's going to believe what we have heard or what we have witnessed to? Who's going to believe that Jesus was born lying in a manger as a little boy? Who's going to believe that story when you tell it? And that's the thought here. And I want to have us to look at John, the 12th chapter. John, the 12th chapter. 7. We sometimes say, why do we need the Old Testament? We wouldn't have the Bible if it wasn't for God. We wouldn't have this church here if it wasn't for God. We say sometimes that we are the temple of God. And that's true. God lives in us if we believe. But look what John says in the New Testament concerning what Isaiah has already said years and years and years before John came to write this Gospel of John. Even though he had performed so many signs in their presence, they did not believe in him. This was to fulfill the word of Isaiah, the prophet, who said, Lord, who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? This is why they were unable to believe, because Isaiah also said, he has blinded their eyes and hardened their hearts, so that they would not see with their eyes or understand with their hearts, and turn, and I will heal them. Isaiah said these things because he saw his glory and spoke about them, about him. Nevertheless, many did believe in him, even among the rulers. But because of the Pharisees, they did not confess him, so that they would not be banned from the synagogue. For they loved human praise more than praise from God. So there goes the question. Asked. Isaiah said it. John referred it again and reemphasized it. Who will believe? Do you believe? If someone were to ask you if you were a Christian, if you believed in God, what would you say? In the Beacon newsletter from the First Baptist Church of Lynn, David had put an article in there that of a woman who was asked, do you believe in God? And that's all part of witnessing. When we go out to witness with someone, you know, we want to ask them, do you believe in God? I wonder how many people do that on a daily basis. We meet someone, do we ask them, do you believe in God? Well, this woman was asked, do you believe in God? Well, she answered, yes, I believe in God. And there was a sociologist by the name of Grace Davey who put the questions just a little bit further than that, you know. And so she asked the lady, do you believe in a personal God? To which she replied, no. The next question was, do you believe in a God who does miracles? And who disclosed himself in the Son Jesus Christ? Again, her reply was no. So this frustrated me. Grace. And so she said a little bit further, do you believe in a God who can change the course of events on earth? to this question, she also said no. So finally, Grace said in desperation, "What kind of God do you believe in?" To which this woman replied, "Just the ordinary one." So the question this morning that you and I face is our God just an ordinary God? Is that the way we perceive Him in our life? I thought about that for a while, just an ordinary God. When God is all of these things in the way that she was asked, if He is our God, then He is God. God is not just an ordinary God to me. He's the God who loves me always, day in and day out. Maybe I don't deserve God's love, but God still loves me. God wants to save me. He's a God who cares about the things I do and where I go. He's a God who is always here, 24/7. He's there. And all I have to do is call upon Him. That's the kind of God He is. He's a God who hears my prayer, saves me. He's awesome. And I know you've heard that on many a young person's voice. He's awesome. He's a powerful, powerful Lord God Almighty. We can know that He is here and will be with us everywhere we go. In the book of Daniel, I like the story about Daniel in the lion's den. I also like the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace. Could you think of a worse circumstances that you might have been in than that? Who's going to believe those stories? Sometimes that's what we call them. Jonah and the whale. Who's going to believe that someone got swallowed by a big old fish and was in the belly of that fish for 3 days before he was spit out of the land? Can't you just see someone walking down the street and saying, "Hey, I got swallowed by a big whale"? Because God wants me to tell you all about Him and what He's about, how mighty a God He is. Who's going to believe? That's quite a question, isn't it? I don't think I've ever been in a circumstance as grave as these. Well, I can tell you a few stories of what I've seen that just because God was with me, I'm here. Praise God. He does not give up. Well, who's going to believe? The conclusion from this message, I think, for us today is we just got to keep telling the story over and over and over again. Over the mountain, over the hills, and everywhere, that Jesus Christ is Lord. That He has saved us. And He wants us to stand face to face with Him. When our time is up here, so that we will know that all of the way that we have walked has not been in vain. And everything that we have said concerning him has not been in vain, because somebody is going to believe. God has it all set out. He has every step of our life planned, every day. He knows who he wants to save. He wants to save all of his people. I looked at the part where it said, he has hardened, he has blinded their eyes and hardened their hearts. And that's why they don't believe. Well, we see from past history, God has done that particular thing, but yet the door is always open. If we want to know God, we have to open that door and allow him to come in. The thought here is that God, who hardened their hearts, and can also soften those hearts. He wants to save every one of his people. All we do, we must believe. We must believe. And so I say to us, if we want the answer to that question, who's going to believe, we just have to keep telling the story and allow God to save them. And he will. He will. But you rest assured, let's pray. Lord, our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for being in our midst, for giving us your word. Help us, Lord, every day of our lives to keep telling the story, to be the witness you would have us to be, whether it's in a shopping center, whether it's at school, whether it's even here at church. If we see and know that someone has a need, whether it's for prayer or whether it's for salvation, Lord, to that cause you came. So help us to tell that story, no matter where we go. Your will be done, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Stand and sing our invitation again. I think the number is 317.